Mr. Heseltine, as a defender of the free enterprise capitalist system, are you not in fact defending something which has already changed out of all recognition, to say the great 19th century capitalists and entrepreneurs? Don't we now have not a free enterprise capitalist system, but at very least a mixed economy with heavy socialization? Are you therefore trying to turn the clock back or simply stop any more socialization?
No, the Conservative Party in the historical context was never the party of laissez-faire. We were always the party on the side of protection. If we felt that that helped the national interest, what we of course believe today is that the strengths of the free enterprise system are very real and are based upon a fundamental analysis of human motivation, and therefore we want to give it a climate in which it can contribute to this country the benefits that it did historically and that are to be seen throughout the world.
But in your free enterprise capitalist system, is there a positive role for the nationalised industries and for the increased nationalised industries that there may be by the time there becomes a Tory government?
I think that we would regret that the nationalised sector of the industrial economy is as substantial as it is. We wish that it hadn't happened, and we did everything we could at the time to stop it happening. And if I had to call evidence to support the justification for that, the study which was published a few days ago by the National Economic Development Organization, a government organization, which was based on detailed interviews with trade unionists, managers, civil servants and politicians, all of whom panned the way in which nationalization had worked out in this country. So we don't want to go any further down that road. But the fact is, a very considerable part of our manufacturing economy has now become part of the state apparatus. And therefore there is a responsibility, which we recognized in the last Conservative administration, to do whatever we could to try and make the system work as well as we can. I don't want to tell you that I think it was always successful or that anyone has yet found the way to do it, but that's a political problem and we ought to talk about it in political terms. But certainly we did try and we would try again to make significant parts of it work as effectively as we could.
But what I'm putting to you, Mr. Heseltine, is that when you stand up at Tory party conference and make a very impassioned address for free enterprise and capitalism, which goes down enormously well with the audience, in fact you're defending something that no longer exists in the terms in which you are really speaking about it.
I don't think that people would accept that. The vast majority of people in this country work for companies that are free enterprise companies. The small industrial community, the self-employed community, is a very large and significant contributor to the national economy. And I think, I think the evidence is there to prove this, that that is the sort of system that most people want to see continued. But that is not to say that you can turn the clock back in every industry which has fallen into state hands. We haven't suggested that.
But what you are saying is that capitalism, far from dying and withering away, as Marx says, is a positive force in the second half of the 20th century. Is that what you're saying?
I think that Britain is at a crossroads. I only know of two ways to motivate a great industrial economy. The one is to take power increasingly into the hands of the state, to compel and to direct and to allocate and to have a master plan within which the industrial society is forced to operate. That's one way, and it is the way associated with the extreme left-wing societies of the world. The only other way is to put a much greater faith in the response you can evoke from ordinary men and women or companies, and that means you have to have incentive and reward. You have to have profits for companies, and you have to have the prospect of increasing wages for people. That is the other way, the way I believe in. The evidence that I see throughout human history, and certainly throughout the world today, is that the societies that have trusted the people personally, individually, first of all have got better results for the rest of the community, secondly have maintained freedom in that society. And so I'm firmly on that side of the argument.
You equate capitalism with freedom. I think you did once say that you can have unfree societies which are capitalist, but you can't have if I'm going to get it right, I'll try and get it right. But that freedom capitalism is essential to a free society.
Oh yes, because of this economic concentration. Yes, you're absolutely right. Yes, capitalist system is in fact the system that spreads power widely throughout society. Now we can talk about how you improve the spread of power and how you make its operation more fairly, but what you cannot doubt is that capitalism means that millions of people both own and operate within the freedom of the capitalist system. The only alternative method is to have the elimination of that freedom by concentrating the decisions in the hands of local and national government.
Now, you hinted earlier on, I think, that profit has become something of a dirty word these days. Yes. How do you make it not a dirty word?
Well, to me, one of the most interesting challenges of the last 2.5 years in opposition has been the argument, the battle, the attempts I've been making to try and persuade industrial management to wake up to the fact that they cannot expect the sort of capitalist society in which I believe in, the sort of free enterprise climate that I want to see, to flourish unless there is a general acceptability amongst the community at large that profit is a recognized and important part of the system. And the fact is that for decades, I mean, it isn't important how long, for far too long, those people who have had the opportunity to talk to people working for industry, the customers of industry, about the meaning of profit, simply haven't done it. The result is that there is a great misunderstanding about the meaning and significance of profit. That's a great mistake and something which I've been urging industrial management to put right, and they are beginning to do so.
Has it also been a failure of the Tory parties as well, that the Tory party of recent years has not spoken out loudly enough and clearly enough in the capitalist faith, as it were?
Well, we have to take a share of responsibility for that, of course. If there has been a misunderstanding, if there has been a failure to educate and communicate and to involve millions of people in the companies for which they work, then as a politician of the right, I have to accept that and recognize it. What it is not is in any way a suggestion that we should move to the left. What we should try and do is to make the right work more effectively, as they have done in Germany, is the classic and often quoted country where there is a much greater sense of partnership and cooperation between management and trade unions. America, the trade unions are extremely powerful, but powerful in the pursuit of the rewards of a free enterprise economy. And that's the essence of what I believe in.
Now, you have argued, and I said that earlier, that the British trade unionist shares the aspirations of the Tory party, yet the leadership of the British trade union movement is committed to keeping a Labour government in power. Is there not therefore a contradiction in what you say and the reality of events?
No, I think sadly that we then come back to one of the great problems of Britain. We have become an apathetic society. We don't bother to vote in local government, we don't bother to vote in trade union elections, and all we do is complain like hell at the people who then get elected don't do what we want them to do. And the fact of the matter is that I would accept many of the logic of that argument as applied to things that happen in the Conservative Party. So, but we're not here to talk about that today. But talking about the trade union movement, I do believe that if all the evidence about what trade union members actually want when they're asked, and they've got to answer, was translated into votes for shop stewards and conveners and officials of their unions, then we would see a very different trade union movement in this country. Certainly no less powerful, maybe more powerful, but arguing about different things. Perhaps I can give you some examples. The process of involving people in the companies for which they work, if you look at what the people working on the shop floor of British industry actually want, they want a greater dialogue. So do I. Who do they want the dialogue with? They want it with management, because they know in the last resort that it is only management that can tell them the harsh facts, or the pleasant facts as they may be, about the conditions on the shop floor where it affects the people concerned. They do not want, and they have said it very clearly, they do not want that dialogue to be conducted by trade union officials. They want to talk straight to management. Now, it is a failure of management that the situation can have so developed that the trade unions can have so become involved that actually the people on the shop floor are not getting the service from management that they want. Now, that I don't blame trade unions for getting involved in that, but I do believe that the people who have failed to become involved in the evolution of a genuine, thriving democracy in trade unionism have allowed it to happen, and therefore they've got something that they don't actually want.
But it is, if should there be a Tory government, it is the leaders of the trade union movements with whom you will have to do deals, with whom you will have to negotiate, with whom you will have to talk. Or do you envisage the possibility of a Tory government speaking over the heads of the trade union leaders, over the heads of the Jack Joneses, the Tom Jacksons, to the rank and file, to the ordinary trade unionists?
I think that we have to do two things. We were the party that set up the most comprehensive institution for talking with trade unions in government, and that was the NEDI organisation, which Harold Macmillan set up in the very early 1960s. And there will undoubtedly be a continuation of that dialogue, which is now very deeply spread throughout the British industrial scene, and nobody would quarrel about that. But the trade union leader, as much as the politician, is elected, and he responds to the pressures which lead to his election. If he is having to argue with small groups of people who turn up at his meetings, and they are the more militant, the more extreme, the more socialist orientated, he's bound to be more likely to talk their language, because that is his constituency. He knows, therefore, that for his re-election, for the power of his own particular job, he's got to be seen to be associated with the policies of the left. Now, if a new mood in this country about making the free enterprise system work is to come about, all of us, the government, the industrial management, and I believe millions of trade union members, have got to shift the basis of that dialogue so that actually the trade union leader realizes, as he would in America or Germany, that he isn't just talking to a small clique of people who turn up above the pub when no one else wants to bother. He's talking to an informed and involved shop floor that actually want to hear him talk about things that matter. What do matter? How are you going to get the real standard of living of the lads on the shop floor up? How are we going to get productivity up? How are we going to get a better industrial relations? How are we going to get the government to have a meaningful, real dialogue? Where is profit going to be earned? Where is profit going to be divided? How are shareholders, who actually happen in the main to be the trustees of the people who work in British industry through the pension funds and the life insurance companies, how are all those people going to play a more meaningful role? Those are the issues. And it is because we as a nation have for too long talked just about the theories of politics and not got down to try and involve people in the real dilemmas facing the chaps out there that we have so many problems.
You are, in fact, saying that the Tory party and the Tory leadership must have a dialogue with the trade union rank and file.
Absolutely,
and
yes.
And that is perhaps their most important task, is
well,
it?
A third of the trade unionists, a third of trade union members vote Conservative. A higher proportion of their wives vote Conservative. And no Conservative government could ever be elected were it not for the fact that those millions of votes from the trade union movement come our way. Nobody can deny today that the by-election results are indicating a very substantial shift in industrial, previously Labour-held areas in favour of the Conservative Party. Now, I don't want to, because this is a serious programme with people who've got a very deep experience. I don't want to say that that means there is a permanent shift in British political dialogue. I think that it is a significant one, one that the Conservatives have got to fight to hold. But what it shows, absolutely beyond any shadow of doubt, because the level of polls are so high that it can't be explained any other way, that the trade union member is looking at the traumas for Britain over the last maybe 20 years, but certainly over the last 5 to 6 years, and is listening with a quite new and open approach to the argument of the right.